could touch my heart like you do. I could search for eternity long and find there is none like you. If you know the song, join in and worship God.
Like you.
Yes, oh God, no one can touch.
No one else can touch my heart like you do. I could search for all eternity long and find there is none like you. Your mercy flows like a river wide, and healing comes from your hands. Suffering children are safe in your arms. There is none like you. There is none like you. No one else can touch my heart like you do. I could search for all eternity long and find there is none like you. There is none like you. No one else can touch my heart like you do. I could search for all eternity long and find there is none like you. I could search for all eternity long and find there is none like you.
Yes, indeed, there is none like you. Once again, we'd like to welcome all of you who just flow in into worship with us. Shall we all rise as we read our call of worship in Psalm 100? Shall we read together? Ready? 3, 2, 1.
Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth.
Serve the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. Know that the Lord, he is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gate with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him, bless his name. For the Lord is good, his steadfast love endures forever. And his faithfulness through all generations. Amen. Let's continue to worship God by singing this song, How Good It Is to Give Thanks Unto the Lord.
How good it is to give thanks unto the Lord.
Yes.
How good it is to give thanks unto our God. Oh, he heals the brokenhearted, binding up the wounds. It is good to bless his holy name. How good it is to give thanks unto the Lord. How good it is to give thanks unto our God. Oh, he heals the brokenhearted, binding up their wounds. It is good to bless his holy name.
Stop and clap your hands.
Sing, shout, clap your hands. Give praise unto your Maker. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord. maker, for the Lord, He is Almighty God. Sing, shout, clap your hands, give praise unto your maker. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord. Sing, shout, clap your hands, give praise unto your maker, for the Lord, He is Almighty God. This is the day of celebration. This is the day to rejoice, rejoice. The Lord our God is our deliverer. So let's just praise His name. Sing, shout, clap your hands, give praise unto your Maker. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord. Sing, shout, clap your hands, give praise unto your Maker, for the Lord, He is Almighty God. This is the day of celebration. This is the day to rejoice. The Lord our God is our deliverer. So let's just praise His name. Sing, shout, clap your hands, give praise unto your Maker. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord. Sing, shout, clap your hands, give praise unto your Maker, for the Lord, He is Almighty God. For the Lord, He is Almighty God. For the Lord, He is Almighty God.
Father, we know that, Lord, You are here. As the word says, wherefore two or three are gathered, I in the midst of them, O God. Father, at this moment, Lord, help us to open our hearts and to lift our hands, Lord, and surrender our hearts, Lord, to You, God. For You desire our worship. Lord, have Your way, O God. Let's make this as a prayer to God. It's between you and God. Yes, God, keep on. This is my desire to honor You, Lord, with all my heart, I worship You. I give You praise. All that I adore is in You. Yes, Lord, it is.
Lord, I give You my heart, I give You my soul. I live for You alone, every breath that I take, every moment I'm awake. Lord, have Your way in me.
This is my desire.
my desire to honor you, Lord, with all my heart, I worship you, worship you. All I have within me, I give.
We are willing, O Lord, to give our heart to you, Lord. You are the one who searches my heart. Father, let us not to be a man of words only, but a man of action. Lord, use us, O God. Waiting right now.
I give you my heart. I give you my soul.
Oh Lord, I give you my heart. Yes.
Lord, I give you my heart. I give you my soul. I live for you alone. Every breath that I take, every moment I'm awake, Lord, have your way in me. Lord, I give you my heart, I give you my soul. I live for you alone, every breath that I take, moment I'm awake. Lord, have your way in me.
Yes, O God, come. Have your way, Lord, in us, O God. Father Jesus, you are the highest honor, O God. We want to give you praise as we sing this song together. Let's testify to one another. Indeed, Jesus shall take the highest honor.
Jesus shall take the highest honor. Jesus shall take the highest praise. Let all the join heaven in exalting the name which is above all other names. Let's bow the knee in humble adoration, for at his name every knee must bow. God's only Son. Sovereign Lord, we give you glory now for all honor and blessing and power belongs to you, belongs to you. Take the highest honor. Jesus shall take the highest praise. Let all of join heaven in exalting the name which is above our other name. Let's bow the knee in humble adoration. His name, every knee must bow. Let every tongue confess he is Christ, God's only Son. Sovereign Lord, we give you glory now for all honor and blessing and power belongs to you. Belongs to you, our honor and blessing and power. Belongs to you, belongs to you, Lord Jesus Christ. You are the Son of the living God. For all honor and blessing and power belongs to you, belongs to you. All honor and blessing and power belongs to you, belongs to you, Lord Jesus Christ. You are the Son of the living God, Lord Jesus Christ, Son of the living God. Hallelujah.
Amen. Amen. And hallelujah, Lord. Indeed, you are the Son of the living God. For honor, blessing, all belongs to you. Lord, you are the name above all name. Therefore, O God, we want to worship you in one voice and one heart.
Hallelujah.
Lord, as we sing again, for the glory and honor, shall we sing the chorus again?
For our honor and blessing and power belongs to you. Christ.
continue to sing. We continue to worship God together. Please visit. Of course, it's our honor to invite our Pastor Liner to share with us the Word of God. Pastor Liner.
Well, thank you, Jonathan and the worship team. It's my privilege to be here today to share with you God's Word.
Yes, thank you, Luke.
Forgot about this. It's my last message to all of you before I become a father. So if in the future, when I give the messages and there's a lot of analogies about children and babies, please forgive me because that's what usually happens. Okay, let's just pray before we go into God's Word. Let's pray. Search us, O God, and know our heart. Test us and know our anxious thoughts. See if there's any offensive way in us and lead us in the way everlasting. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. So what's in and what's out? Or who's in and who's out? Well, it depends on what you're asking and who you're asking. So it's not switched on. So baggy clothes, like what you see Justin Bieber wearing, they are in. While form-fitting clothes, like what I'm wearing, it's out. So it's like maternity wear is now for everyone, not just for pregnant people. The hairstyle I have right now, which is a undercut with a side parting, is out. Or what's in, or what's back in again, is the center parting, which you can see people like Ryan Chu having. Ryan Chu, give a wave. Unfortunately, I can't do a center parting because, as many of you have noticed, I have a growing bald spot in the middle. So the years haven't been kind to me. So maybe it's kind of a center parting. It's like the parting of the Red Sea. So in all areas of life, there is a tendency to draw lines, to erect boundaries on all kinds of things. Your social class, your interests, or even matters like behavior or beliefs. And this extends to issues of faith as well. Know people who go to XYZ church, are they Christian or not? If you get a tattoo, can you still be considered a good Christian? If you buy 4D, that's lottery, are you a true Christian? And so on. Today we'll look at a group of people who had very strong ideas about who's in and who's out, and what's in and out. They are the Pharisees. So we all know how the story of Matthew goes. The Pharisees are the bad guys. They sought to discredit Jesus, and when they failed, they plotted to have Jesus killed. And so when we think of the word Pharisee, what pops to our mind is usually a cluster of negative attributes, or maybe even faces of individuals to whom we can attach those attributes. So the Pharisees are those who are nitpicky, hypocritical, they don't practice what they preach, they are judgmental because they are self-righteous, they are prideful, or they are maybe deluded, or as young people would put it, they think they are hot, but they are not. And so we draw lines too. The Pharisees are all who fall into the categories on the left, and on the right, that's us, right? CPC, not Pharisees. But let's spend some time to understand the Pharisees within their historical context. So within, throughout the Gospels, there are different groups, you know, the Sadducees, the Zealots, the Pharisees, and so on. And the Sadducees were upper-class elites. They controlled the temple and the Sanhedrin, which is the judicial system. But to the average Israelite, they were seen as compromised sellouts. They cared more about enjoying their wealth, their privileges, than allegiance to Israel's God. But the common folk had great respect for the Pharisees. They were a reform movement from ground up, because the root word of Pharisee means to be set apart or to be holy. And to be a Pharisee, you simply had to come under a rabbi, an established teacher of the law, and become his disciples, almost like the way Jesus did it. And so the Pharisees believed that Israel was called to be a kingdom of priests. We see that in Exodus 19:6. And they sought to apply the whole law to all life, including the priestly regulations in Leviticus. And that's why they had a great concern for ritual purity, like the washing of hands, or matters like tithing of the land, keeping of the Sabbath, and so on. But because the laws in the Torah, the first five books, were geared to an agrarian society, and so there was a need for a tradition of interpretation by rabbis to reapply it to the first century context. Okay, I'm a bit echoey. Now, that's not too different from now, right? We also don't apply scripture wholesale into our modern context. We also appeal to a tradition of interpretation. It just depends on which famous pastor you look up to. So let's not think also that the Pharisees were just concerned about ritual. They also stood against all forms of immorality. They saw themselves as guides for Israel, the chosen people of a holy God. And Israel had to keep itself pure from the corrupting influences of a pagan world. To them, this was a central issue. Israel's place in God's covenant is at stake. Who can be counted worthy to enter God's kingdom was at stake. And so many of us will have sympathies for the Pharisees now. After all, we live in a world that has gone astray, and we worry for ourselves, and we worry even more for our children. So we want to enforce boundaries against the pervasive and pernicious influences of the world. So religiosity, the Pharisees draw lines to maintain its distinctiveness, to avoid defilement. But what's wrong with that? Or to be precise, how has the Pharisees done this line drawing wrongly? Let's read together from Matthew chapter 15, verses 1 to 7. Let's read. Then some Pharisees and teachers of the law came to Jesus from Jerusalem and asked, "Why do your disciples break the tradition of the elders? They don't wash their hands before they eat." Jesus replied, "And why do you break the command of God for the sake of your tradition? For God said, 'Honor your father and mother,' and anyone who curses their father or mother is to be put to death. But you say that if anyone declares what might have been used to help their father or mother is devoted to God, they are not to honor their father or mother with it. Thus, you nullify the word of God for the sake of your tradition." So as we have established, the Pharisees are not OCD or obsessed with cleanliness. Rather, they saw the disciples' actions as breaching the boundaries of purity. So Jesus responds to their charge in verses 1 to 20, and notice that he does not answer them directly, engaging in a debate over how to interpret scripture. Instead, he uses this debate as a teaching moment for all who follow him. And he highlights the problem with line-drawing religiosity. So I'm going to unpack this with 3 points. Number 1, line-drawing deviates. Number 2, line-drawing detracts. And number 3, line-drawing deflects. Okay, we like to alliterate. So first of all, line drawing deviates. It derails us from God's truth and God's intention. As Jesus said in verse 3, "Why do you break the command of God for the sake of your tradition?" And why does this deviate or go off track? It's because it uses the wrong yardstick. Now, I don't think any of us will judge a person's holiness by whether they wash their hands or not, maybe their hygiene. But there are many man-made yardsticks we use. I'm sure all of you know John Piper. He's a famous author and pastor. And 40 years ago, he was a pastor of a new Baptist church, so no street cred yet. And his church had a clause in its constitution which demanded abstinence from alcohol for all its members. And what Piper proposed was that this clause be amended into a commitment, a broader commitment, to seek God's help to abstain from practices that may harm our faith or our body. So it's a commitment, but not a line. And what happened was that John Piper received a lot of pushback, a lot of flack, for being soft on sin, for opening the floodgates to immorality. Because back then, alcoholism and drunkenness was a huge problem. Many lives and many families were destroyed because of it. And so John Piper gave this message to his church. And to him, the debate is not like whether alcohol is good or bad, or how permissive we should be. Rather, he notes that in many churches, they preach countless messages about the need to separate ourselves from worldly practices. So back then, it was things like dancing, social dancing, or drinking, or smoking, or gambling. But very few messages targeted matters like gossip, or having a hateful spirit, or envy. And very few sermons targeted the pride that arose from being separated from the world. So brothers and sisters in Christ, maybe we should honestly examine our own yardsticks. Now the things that we are concerned about may be important and beneficial. Dressing modestly, church attendance, tithing, and so on. And we all have our own pet peeves. We dislike certain work styles, personalities, habits, and so on. But do you project your yardsticks upon God? Does God have the exact same list of priorities in the exact same order as you? Because if your ideal church is filled with people exactly like you, then of course you'll end up nitpicky and judgmental and unloving. This is what Jesus warns about in verses 7 to 9, echoing the words of Isaiah. You hypocrites, Isaiah was right when he prophesied about you. These people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far away from me. They worship me in vain. Their teachings are merely human rules. So the worship of God has to be grounded in truth, in the reality of who God is. If not, we may be claiming to honor God, but we are not. Is the character of Jesus as portrayed in the Gospels your yardstick? If not, we may end up worshipping him in vain, because we are not worshipping God, but ourselves. The second issue with the Pharisees is that their line drawing detracts. It draws attention from what truly matters. Example given in verses 3 to 5 was that someone could declare a portion of their possessions korban, or devoted to God as a gift, which meant that it would be eventually given to the temple. But because they didn't have to give it immediately, they could continue to enjoy the benefits of their field or their house. And this became a way of people to avoid support for their aging parents. See, what I have is already already reserved for God. And to Jesus, this tradition ends up breaking the fifth commandment, honoring one's parents. And this is the very first commandment in the Ten that concerns our responsibilities to our fellow men. In fact, the opposite of honoring, to curse one's mother or father, was seen as a sin deserving of death. Now, I've tried researching the first century context, and I couldn't find any exact regulations on how to honor one's parents. Oh, we must like bow twice to them before we talk. We must give them X amount of your income. And that makes sense because how we show our parents honor changes throughout our life stages. How we honor our parents when we are 5 will be different from how we honor them when we are 15 and when we are 50. So it's really a case-by-case situation. But all of us in our heart of hearts know that we ought to honor our parents. We should at least, at the very least, treat them as we would like to be treated when we are in their situation. which is not merely as a burden or a duty or a spoil sport. We should esteem them, value them with both our words and deeds. And so Jesus used this example brilliantly because he highlights a larger principle at play here. The law is not so much about drawing lines, but charting a path. It's basically what Pastor Henry said last week. It's not about teaching rules, don't do this, don't do that, but teaching values. We see this expressed in Psalms 119, verse 32. I run in the path of your commands, for you have broadened my understanding. And so, if obedience is merely about drawing lines, like what's on the left, then we are merely focused on the passing mark, doing just enough so that we don't fail. But that goes against the essence of a command like honoring our parents. Because our parents, at least for most of us, didn't think like that when they raised us. What is the bare minimum I should put in to be a decent parent? Many of them tried to do the best they could, to the best of their knowledge. And therefore, it's only right that we do the same to them. So if obedience to God is about drawing lines around certain behaviors or actions, then there are only two groups of people. Those in the in crowd, see, I've made it, unlike the rest. And those who are out, those failures, those sinners. But if obedience is a direction, then all of us here are on a journey towards the same goal, towards following Christ. And none of us are there yet. Now, let me qualify. I'm not saying that boundaries or lines should be discarded. Please, to all the yaya here, don't leave here thinking, woohoo, Pastor Lionel says no boundaries, and next week you stroll into service at 12 with a bottle of vodka in hand. So my hair is already getting less and less. Please, don't make it disappear completely. So draw lines around your weak points, not your strong points. If you are the achievement-oriented type, you need to be needed by others, then draw lines around your periods of rest. Be firm about the times that you are still before God. If you struggle with lust, then be aware of what tempts or triggers you and put boundaries around that. Find people you can be accountable to. Draw boundaries around your weak points. Because if you merely make your yardstick or you set boundaries around what you are already good at, what you don't fail at, then it's easy to end up proud and self-righteous. You think that you're hot when you're not. The final point that Jesus makes from verses 10 to 11 and 16 to 20 is that drawing lines deflect. It prevents us from facing the main problem. It's like fixing a sinking ship with a new coat of paint. Jesus says in verse 11, what goes into someone's mouth does not defile them, but what comes out of their mouth, that's what defiles them. He goes on to say in verse 18 and 19, the things that come out of a person's mouth come from the heart, and this defile them. For out of the heart come evil thoughts, murder, adultery, theft, and so on. Note that Jesus is not saying, well, look at the state of the world today. All these famous people are having affairs, getting divorces, so terrible. Jesus is going straight for your heart and my heart. The heart, in the Jewish understanding, is the center of our will and our affections. The heart, your heart and my heart, is the source of our defilement. For out of the heart flow two things, what we say and how we think. And as Jesus said on the Sermon on the Mount, being angry with someone or calling someone a fool makes us liable for judgment. We may not actually commit murder, but what we think and what we say and what we may do eventually, it springs from that same hellish desire that flows from the heart. Notice the list of sin he covers in verse 19. So they can be almost completely paralleled by the 6th to the 10th commandments. Murder, 6th commandment. you shall not murder, adultery and sexual immorality, seventh commandment, and so on and so forth. It's only the last sin of slander that is different. Although you can easily argue that slander comes from coveting, because we tear down someone's reputation, we feel that they don't deserve what they have. And so we have reached the central premise of the Christian faith. Jesus uses the law not for line-drawing religiosity or even path-charting discipleship. He uses it for open-heart surgery. By the way, I placed an optional reading in this week's study guide about Calvin's three uses of the law, which you can read on your own time. So this gives us a good theological framework to think about how Scripture uses law. But back to my main point, the Russian novelist Solzhenitsyn, I think that's how you say it, was a Red Army captain, but he was sentenced to a gulag, a labor camp, after World War II. And he said this, "During my most evil moments, I was convinced that I was doing good and I was well supplied with systematic arguments." But it was in prison that Solzhenitsyn had an awakening and returned to the Christian faith of his childhood. He said, "If only it were so simple. If only there was evil people somewhere committing evil deeds, and it were necessary only to separate them and from the rest of us and destroy them. But the line dividing good and evil cuts through the heart of every human being. And who is willing to destroy a piece of his own heart?" So religiosity, whether Christian or otherwise, it can change behaviors. Let's give it credit. The Pharisees lived moral, disciplined lives compared to the common folk, and especially compared to the sinners that gathered around Jesus. But man-made religiosity cannot transform the fountain of defilement that is the human heart. Verse 13, "Because religiosity is not planted by God, it will be uprooted and rejected and thrown away by God." Verse 14, Jesus likens man-made religiosity to the blind leading the blind. A Pharisee thinks that everyone should follow them because they are the example, but the whole group ends up falling into the pit. And what's the main pitfall of man-made religiosity? In the message by John Piper I quoted from earlier, he says this, "I see 10 million more people in hell because of legalism than because of alcoholism. Legalism is a more dangerous disease than alcoholism because it doesn't look like one. Alcoholism makes men fail, legalism helps them succeed. Alcoholism makes men depend on the bottle, legalism makes them self-sufficient, depending on no one. Alcoholics don't feel welcome in church. Legalists love to hear their morality extolled in church." But enough of the Pharisees in a general sense. Let's turn the words of Jesus on ourselves. Maybe it's time for us to stop deflecting, pushing the blame to society, to our family, to others. Maybe it's time to stop deflecting by focusing on the faults of others. Because if we let the dividing line of be drawn by the sword of God's word, then we are the ones who are unclean. We are the ones who are defiled. Just touching on a few here. Commandment 7, "You shall not commit adultery." And as Jesus puts it, anyone who looks at someone else with lust has already committed adultery in their own hearts. Commandment 9, "You shall not bear false witness." Do we slander others, spread unverified, juicy nuggets about them? Commandment 10, "You shall not envy," or put in other words, resent and desire what someone else has. And perhaps the most dangerous of all is pride, because pride is the worship of self, the love of self at the expense of God and others. And so, by God's yardstick, we are, to put it bluntly, out. That's what Jesus wanted his hearers That's what he wants us to know today. And let's move on to the next part, which is verses 21 to 28. So don't worry, I'm not going to leave all of us as outsiders. This will resolve. So let's read this together. 3, 2, 1. Leaving that place, Jesus withdrew to the region of Tyre and Sidon. A Canaanite woman from that vicinity came to him crying out, "Lord, Son of David, have mercy on me. My daughter is demon-possessed and suffering terribly." Jesus did not answer a word. So his disciples came to him and urged him, "Send her away, for she keeps crying out after us." He answered, "I was sent only to the lost sheep of Israel." The woman came and knelt before him. "Lord, help me," she said. He replied, "It is not right to take the children's bread and toss it at the dogs." "Yes, it is, Lord," she said. "Even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from their master's table." Then the woman said to her, "Woman, you have great faith. Your request is granted." And her daughter was healed at that moment. So this example of the woman's religiosity is deliberately set up as a contrast to the Pharisees. Unlike the Pharisees' religiosity, which draw lines, the woman shows us a deep faith that crosses lines. To give a bit of background, Jesus ends up in Tyre, which is not just a Gentile region, but a center of idolatry as shown in the Old Testament. And he probably ended up there because he really angered the Pharisees, and so he had to lay low for a while. And Jesus is approached, or rather ambushed, by a Canaanite woman. And in the parallel account in Mark, she's called a Syrophoenician woman. But Matthew really wants to highlight to all of us that this woman, at least to a typical Jew, is really the height of a defiled person, someone to stay clear from. She's a Canaanite. She's a descendant of the sworn enemies of Israel. And her daughter is demon-possessed. So she's the ultimate outsider. But Jesus remains silent in the face of the woman's pleas. And his disciples get annoyed. "Send her away," they urge him. And Jesus makes two statements that seem to support their demand, you know, very exclusionary. Verse 24, "I was sent only to the lost sheep of Israel." And verse 26, "It is not right to take the children's bread and toss it to the dogs." Now, Jesus wasn't just trying to be mean. There's some extenuating factors, which is firstly, Jesus' earthly ministry was focused towards the Jews. The time had not come for his wider ministry to the Gentiles. And secondly, Jesus wasn't using the standard word for dog, which were considered unclean scavengers then. The word was kuon, but he uses the word kunaron, which is a term for household pets. So it's like dog versus a doggy. Okay? Regardless, there is still this clear implication from the passage that this woman wasn't really his priority. It's not like now where you go to the park and you see someone carrying their gigantic dog around because the dog got tired. So it's not like a dog, but it's like a porran and a fur kid. That's what they say. This woman's place was not at the table with the children. But in the face of that, the woman does not give up or even get offended. She answers back, "Even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall off the master's table." And Jesus commends her for her great faith and grants her request. Now, there's something we can learn from this woman. See, her faith crosses lines, as in it's inappropriate. She's very thick-skinned. She doesn't stop pestering Jesus. It's like, crosses lines. But her faith also crosses lines. It moves her from out to in. It's her faith that gets praised by Jesus. Now, we are not a very traditional church. We don't usually do prayers before communion. But I think this prayer, called the Prayer of Humble Access, really shows this woman's posture. And can we just read this together? "We do not presume to come to this your table, O merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your abundant and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under your table, but you are the same Lord whose character is always to have mercy. See, brothers and sisters in Christ, the opposite of legalism is not liberalism. Liberalism is like, who cares about the rules? Let's do whatever we want. The opposite of legalism is faith. It is this humble yet audacious trust in Jesus. It's a humble faith. It recognizes, as the woman did, that our place is not at the table. It's a faith that recognizes, like the woman did, that we really have nothing to offer God except to, like, beg Him. So why is Christianity fundamentally different from other religions? See, Christianity is not a philosophical, ethical, or spiritual system, a standard by which we evaluate who's in and who's out. Christianity is this proposal that we are all out, and God invites all of us in because of His grace and mercy. And so the church is not a gathering of squeaky, clean, moral paragons like the Pharisees. It's a gathering of defiled people who know the defilement of their hearts. The church is a place for people who have come to the end of themselves. Christianity, if really understood, kills all possibility of Pharisaic pride. We cannot boast in anything of ourselves. We can only boast in what God has done. But this faith that the woman represents is not just a humble faith, but the audacious, a bold one. A faith that is bold because its focus is not on her own unworthiness, but on Jesus. Yes, our sins may be great, but His grace is greater. He is the same Lord whose character is always to have mercy. So, brothers and sisters in Christ, we have so much more grounds than this woman to have confidence in Christ. Unlike the woman who has only heard stories of Jesus' power, He's the Messiah, He's maybe the Messiah, we have heard the good news of Christ. Unlike the woman, we know that Jesus is really and fully for us. While we are His enemies, while we lived in sin and rejected His ways, He willingly died for us. He gave His life on the cross, paying the price for our sins, so that we can be forgiven and free. Unlike the woman, we know the full extent of the salvation of Christ. He not only delivers us from the challenges on earth, but He also defeats sin and death. He is able to save to the uttermost all who put their trust in Him. So Ephesians chapter 3, verse 16 and 17 says this: out of His glorious riches, He may strengthen you with power through His Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. So though the human heart is naturally a fountain of defilement, Christ comes to us by His Spirit to make it new and to make it His home. And this reality is experienced through faith as we put our trust in Him. See, there is this sense in the story where Jesus, you know, holds back. And because He holds back, the woman's faith is exercised and exhibited. And we now see her faith as a shining example. It's a faith that is both bold and beautiful. And Jesus has said before, blessed are those who have not seen and yet believe. And I believe there's going to be stories told in heaven about the bold and beautiful faith of many of us here. Some of you may be struggling, maybe with sin, habitual sin, and you have been asking God for a breakthrough. But it's so hard to break out of that. And what I say to you, just like the woman, don't give up. Keep seeking God. Keep putting your trust in Him. Or maybe some of you have a burden in your heart for a close friend or relative, and you have been praying for a long time that they will open their hearts to Jesus. But nothing is happening, and you are wondering if God's silence means that it's a firm no forever. But keep clinging on to God's promises. Keep persisting, just like the woman. That's what faith is. It's a faith that is humble yet bold. Finally, I go to my last point. And this is, I'll do so quickly. So actually, Matthew 15 has enough content for 3 sermons in one. But let's read together from Matthew 15, verse 32 to 35. Jesus called his disciples to him and said, "I have compassion for these people. They have already been with me 3 days and have nothing to eat. I do not want to send them away hungry, or they may collapse on the way." His disciples answered, "Where could we find enough bread in this remote place to feed such a crowd?" "How many loaves do you have?" Jesus asked. 7, they replied, "and a few small fish." He told the crowd to sit down on the ground. Then he told the 7, and when he given thanks, he broke them and gave them to the disciples, and they in turn to the people. This time round, Jesus ends up in the region of Decapolis, which is a Gentile region on the other side of the Sea of Galilee. So we know that from reading the parallel passage in Mark. Crowds of Gentiles are coming to him for help, and they witness his miracles, his power over diseases and demons. And importantly, they glorified the God of Israel. All these Gentiles who don't know the law, who worship other gods, they wanted more of Jesus. And they stayed with him for 3 whole days until they were out of food. And Jesus called his disciples to him and invited them to see the crowds as he does, with the same eyes of compassion, as people who he cares about, whom he will not send away hungry. But the disciples only see the magnitude and the impossibility of the task at hand. Where can we get enough bread in such a remote place to feed such a crowd? So one chapter earlier in Matthew 14, Jesus had already multiplied 5 loaves and 2 fishes, and he fed thousands of people, mostly Jews. But for whatever reason, the disciples doubted that he can do the same again. And so once again, Jesus did the same thing. He asked the disciples to pass him what they had at hand. He gave thanks, he broke the food, and he passed it back out to the disciples, and the disciples distributed it to the crowd. And there was more than enough for thousands of them. All ate and were satisfied. And so there are many principles we can learn from this story. God's provision, for example, or how he invites his disciples to partner with him for this work. Because notice that he multiplies the food the disciples had, and they were the ones to distribute the food to the crowd. But I think the central point of this passage, in the larger context of Matthew 15, is clear to us. Jesus redraws lines. He included those that are deemed as outsiders into his fold. And in fact, he calls all who follow him, his disciples, to be part of this work of line redrawing. Now, Dr. Ed has shared with all of you about the Jesus movement. In the late 60s, revival broke up among the hippies, and this movement impacted the world. And in fact, Dr. Ed was one of them. He was a self-termed Jesus freak. And one of the epicenters of the Jesus movement was a small church of less than 50 in Orange, in OC, California, called Calvary Chapel. And there's this movie that covers this story, which you can watch. It's called The Jesus Revolution. It was just recently released, I think, the start of this year. So after the Summer of Love in 67, hordes of hippies descended upon California because the weather there was warmer, and drugs were circulating like candy, and the local residents were all horrified to see all these disheveled and unwashed young people lying on the streets and spaced out on drugs. There was this pastor, Chuck Smith, and his wife, Kay, and it was the heart of Kay that God first stirred. She sensed God telling her that these young people were hungry and they didn't know what they were hungry for. What or who they really needed was Him. And she would tell her husband, they just need the Lord. And he would reply to them, what they need is a bath. But gradually, Chuck came around and they both started to pray that God would open doors for them to understand and interact with this group more. And one day, Chuck Smith's daughter met a hippie couple and invited them over to their home. And one thing led to another, and suddenly, Calvary Chapel had barefoot and outlandishly dressed young people filling their sanctuary. Some of the lay leaders got upset. They complained to Chuck, these hippies are messing up and dirtying our new carpet with their feet. Yet on the next Sunday, a line of people, young people, were waiting to get into church. And Chuck Smith was at the doorstep, washing the feet of all who came in, saying, welcome, glad you are here. And of course, after that, some long-time church members left the church. And many of these hippies were homeless. Some lived in hippie pads, where drugs were so common that they soon fell back into it. But the members of Calvary Chapel rose up together. A member rented a small house for new converts to live in, but within 2 weeks, it was already packed to the brim with young people. Another offered a motel he owned to serve as a Christian commune. And just within the span of a few months, Calvary Chapel was baptizing hundreds of people per month. And this was despite much criticism from other churches. Over the years, the movement grew, and more churches were started as many hippies moved to other places to find jobs and raise families. And today, there are more than 1,000 Calvary Chapel churches and Bible colleges worldwide. So I'm not saying that this Jesus movement was perfect. Like every other movement with humans, there will be errors, there will be people who fall away. But there is no doubt that God used this humble community to impact a group and even a whole generation that many church people had more or less given up hope in. You know, we always say that CPC is a family church. And I hope that doesn't mean that we are like a natural biological family. People only come in through marriage or by being born. What does the reality that Jesus redraws lines mean for us today? Maybe instead of giving you steps, let me take you through a hypothetical scenario and think through the implications for us. Let's say one day 100 people come into church, and this is a model example. These people come for genuine reasons. They all want to know more about Jesus. Not just because the potluck last Sunday was very good. Wow, I don't want to miss out on all the food. So what would that mean for us here? Well, it may mean that Pastor Henry won't be there to entertain your complaints anymore. Why things are always like this? Why people sit in my seat? Why all these new people don't know how to follow our protocol? Now he's already so busy. But if the church really grows, it means that his attention will be focused on the new members. It may mean that people will bring in their baggages, their issues, because more people means, of course, more problem. I mean, we ourselves have our own baggages, right, despite being Christians for so long. Some of you may have to leave your life groups that you have been part of for decades to step out as leaders. And I speak to especially the Yaya here. It will definitely mean that you have to extend your circle of friends in church. Cannot be like, wow, this new person, I cannot have my own insider conversations anymore. And this is just a modest scenario. Because when revival comes throughout history, it's far messier than that. I did not include the fact that we as a church will have to invest effort and time into actually reaching out. which is to evangelize and to serve the wider world, like what Calvary Chapel did. I did not include the fact that when God redraws our lives, He usually includes people that are very different from us. So what I just did was to lay out the course of redrawing lines. But I'm sure, brothers and sisters in Christ, but that many of you here are not just satisfied with maintaining the status quo of religiosity, of going through the motions of church. I'm sure you want to be channels like the disciples through whom Jesus feeds a searching and hungry world. See, religiosity draws lines to segregate, to separate, to keep itself safe and pure from the world. But true discipleship redraws lines to include the broken, the sinful, and the lost. Religiosity draws lines around its comfort zones, but the disciples follow Jesus to the remote and desolate places of the world. Religiosity limits its scope of work to what we have at hand, but discipleship hands all that we have to Jesus, trusting that wherever God guides, He provides. Religiosity leaves the spiritually hungry locked outside the doors, but discipleship steps out of the door to seek them. Religiosity builds the institutional church. Disciples build lives. Religiosity acts out of calculation. Our church attendance is dropping. Young people are leaving. Don't know if CPC will still be around in 30 years. We need to do something. But discipleship is moved by compassion. And a church community that runs on compassion, on really caring for the people who come in, will always outperform a church community that acts out of calculation. Religiosity sees the crowds as a demand on our own time and resources, but discipleship sees crowds as an opportunity to demonstrate God's glory and goodness. So what kind of church do we want to be? One that draws lines or redraws lines? What priorities do we have as a church? That's a choice for all of us here to make today. Can I invite the worship team on the stage? So in conclusion, before we enter a time of worship, I want to speak to two groups of people here. The first group of people is maybe you haven't put your faith in Christ yet. And there can be, in a sense, good reasons for that, because you have seen the hypocrisy and the pride of the church. You have seen that a lot of it is a facade. But I urge you today to look at who Jesus is, as the Bible puts it. I urge you to see His heart for you. That even though He sees our hearts and we know that we have sinned, He loves us and He died for us. And if you want to put your trust in Jesus, I invite you to speak to someone who has brought you here today, to speak to a Christian, and they will explain more who Jesus really is. Second group of people I want to speak to. You know, God says in His word that He will give us a heart of flesh instead of a heart of stone. And honestly, sometimes we can revert to our heart of stones. We start drawing lines. We start deflecting blame on others. And I just invite us to allow ourselves to place our hearts into God's hands again. And let me pray for us. Father in heaven, dear Lord Jesus, and Holy Spirit, Lord, we know that You dwell in our hearts through faith. We look to You today, and we recognize the defilement of our own hearts. We know that it's not just keeping clean from the world, because, God, in many ways we have fallen short. in many ways we have sinned. But God, we know that you still love us despite our failings. And you call us to extend our love, that same love to others. We ask that this church will be a church that is known for its love for people a lot. Not just ourselves as a community, but for the wider world. Redraw our lines, God. Whatever barriers that we have placed up that may be offensive to you, remove it. Cause our heart to break for what breaks yours. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
Unfailing, overtaking my heart. You take me in, finding peace again. Fear is lost in all you are. And I will give the world to tell your story, cause I know that you called me, I know that you called me. I lost myself for good within your promise, and I won't hide it, I won't hide it. Jesus, I believe in you, and I would go to the ends of the earth, to the ends of the earth for you. Alone I'm the Son of God, and all the world will see you are God, you are God.
Let's continue to worship God with this song.
Love and feeling overtaking my heart. You take me in, finding peace again. Fear is lost in all you. For good within your promise, and I won't hide it, I won't hide it. Jesus, I believe in you, and I would go to the ends of the earth, to the ends of the earth for you. Lord, I'm the Son of God, and all the you are God, you are God. Jesus, I believe in you, and I would go to the ends of the earth, to the ends of the earth for you. Alone I'm the Son of God, and all the world will see you are God.
Let's prepare our hearts for the communion.
Let's reflect on the word of God that's been preached by Pastor Liner this morning. You know, as your senior pastor, I have no illusion at all, that just because we say, read your Bible, study Matthew, go and join a cell group, give your 10% tithing, you know, go and serve in the outreach, go to the nations, that you will do it. You see, at the end of the day, that's what the Word of God has taught us this morning. No amount of rules, lines will cause you to do it unless you encounter the person of Jesus Christ. You know, today, I think the invitation has been made, if you have not known the Lord Jesus Christ, to open your heart. To say, I want to know you. He's not a concept, he's not an idea, he's a person, a real person. And for the rest of us who have been in the church for ages, you know, since Jubilee days, we have our peep, we have our modes or set ways of doing things. This is how we have always done it. But I want to invite you to dream big, you know. The Lord wants us to dream big. You know, not what, just 100, maybe 300, 500 people are going to come into the church. What are we going to do? So I want to invite you to open your heart. Even though you have been a Christian for many years, open your heart. To say, God, I want to encounter you in a new way. I want to experience your love more deeply. So that I'll do all things. Not out of, you know, just because my leaders told me to do it. But because I love to please you, oh God. You know, I may be struggling, but Lord, I know that because I want to please you, I want to please the Lord just more than anything else, I will do it. I will go to the ends of the earth. Shall we all rise and I'll ask Jonathan to lead us in this song, that we will cry out to the Lord, I want to know you. I want to know you deeply. I want to experience the depth of your love. That I will go and do whatever you ask me to do, and I will go where you ask me to go.
Love and feeling overtaking my heart. You take me in, peace again, fear is lost in all you are. And I would give the world to tell your story, cause I know that you called me. I know that you called me. I lost myself for good within your promise.
Yes, loving Father, we pray and ask that God, regardless of where we are, whether we have known you for more than 3-4 decades, or we have known you just recently, or we have not known you, we pray and ask that God, you caused those restlessness, those need to work, to be legalistic, to be purged off, to be rooted off from our hearts. And you, God, I pray and ask that God, you cause us to encounter you afresh, that today will be a new day for all of us to encounter you, to encounter your love afresh. Thank you, Lord. The Lord Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and he said, "Take, eat. This is my body given for you." In the same manner, he took the cup and he says, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood. Pour out for the forgiveness of all your sins. As often as you drink this cup and eat this bread, you do this in remembrance of me." Father God, even as we stand, right now as we stand, we pray and ask that God, you help us all to clothe and to put on your armor. That Lord, in the days ahead, we will stand correctly and accurately representing you as your disciples, as your children. So bless these elements from common use to extraordinary use. Yes, thank you so much for being an extraordinary God who could use ordinary people like us to do extraordinary things. So thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. So church, this bread is the body of Christ. Let us eat this together with thanksgiving. Church, this cup is the blood of Christ. Pour out for our forgiveness. Let us drink this together with thanksgiving. Yes, thank you, God, once again, that nothing could separate us. We thank you, Father God, for sending your Son as a Jew to die for our sins, so that we can be accepted as Gentiles, as non-Jews, into your kingdom. And Father, we pray and ask that God, from this day forward, that we'll resolve to depend, to rely on you more and more. That Lord, you'll help us to grow our faith. Like the woman in this story, and that we can declare your goodness to the world who do not know you. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Amen. Please be seated as I ask Pastor Chris to come and lead us in the time of corporate prayer.
Thank you, Pastor Henry. Good morning. Good afternoon, church. And we want to thank the Lord for the different generations that are in covenant. And it is important for us to take the time to pray for the next generation of believers. And more so, if you hear this message, you realize that many of them are growing in the church and they need to know truly what role they can play in the church. And we want to remember that they will become the future leaders in covenant. And we need to know how to help them fulfill the destiny that God has for each one of them. Statistics has shown that more than half of teenagers who leave church today, they won't return. And statistics also show an increasing number of Christians no longer believe the church is relevant. So we want to turn our concern into specific prayers for the next generation. Can I have the slide, please? I have four pointers for us to pray. The first is to pray for young believers to develop a deeper hunger for the Word of God that will truly transform their lives. And pray that the next generation of believers will recognize, okay, the value, the authority, validity, and the relevance of the Word of God. The second prayer pointer is believers be impassioned to share the gospel of salvation through faith in Jesus. And we want to pray that the next generation of believers will follow God's heart and direction for their lives rather than their own. And they will share Jesus with the people in their spheres of influence. They will touch lives. The third point, that believers will understand who they are in the eyes of their loving Creator and Savior. So pray that the next generation be assured that they have been created in the image of God and are fearfully and wonderfully made, full of purpose and uniqueness for the glory. Last but not least, young believers will love the church as Jesus does. Pray that the next generation believers will connect with the body of Christ and they will use their spiritual gift that God has given to them to serve in the church. So these are some of the prayer pointers that we can pray for them. If you are seated near a young adult, the younger generation, would you just go and pray for them and ask the Lord to fill them as we minister, as we pray for them, shall we? Can we have the first slide first? Yeah. Let's take a few moments and pray for the young people in the midst. Yeah, just turn around. Just recognize. Go to them. That's right. Let's support them. Let's rally around our next generation. So important to pray for them. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Come, Holy Spirit. Come and do a deeper work in our lives, especially for the next generation, Lord. Yes, we see, Lord, your hand upon their lives. We want to see more of your presence in their lives, oh God. Thank you, Lord. We pray that you continue, Lord, to minister to them. Indeed, they are so precious to us. Let's really love them, care for them, disciple them, help them to become the men and women that God wants them to be. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. More of you in our lives. Yes. They will become extraordinary, Lord, disciple, Lord Jesus. Yes. Raise them up. Let's draw our prayer to a close. Father God, we place a desire in the heart of the next generation of believers to not just know about you, but to desire a deeper, more personal faith and to get to know you through the study of your word. Place in them, Lord, a true hunger, Lord, for your word and to live according to your word. Lord Jesus, raise up men and women who will faithfully bear your cross and bring your message of salvation by Jesus alone to the nations. We pray that you will set them on fire for Jesus. Raise up future pastors, evangelists, Bible teachers, small group leaders, and others who will obey your calling for them. And we pray that every believer, Lord, of the next generation be assured of their identity in Christ. They have been created, Lord, in your image and fearfully and wonderfully made to glorify your name. May your Holy Spirit, Lord, empower them to become sons and daughters of the Most High God. For we pray all this in the mighty name of Jesus. And God's people say, amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Let's give the Lord a clap offering. Amen. When we are praying, I just sense a light that's shining upon us. And I know that God is going to raise up the next generation of leaders. Okay, let's go on to the next. We're going to have giving of our tithes and offering, I believe. The slides. Yes. Our worship is never complete without giving unto the Lord. And it says here in the verse, you will be enriched in every way so that you can be generous on every occasion. And through us, your generosity will result in thanksgiving to God. Let's all remember that God has blessed us richly and we need to truly honor him with our tithes and offerings. Okay, the QR code for the tithes and offerings are on the screen as well as behind some of the seats. Let us truly give cheerfully unto the Lord. I'll just give you a moment to do that. Let us pray for the tithes and the offering. Father God, we thank you for your abundant blessings upon our lives and in this church. God, we thank you that you have provided for all our needs. And we recognize that you are the source of all the blessings. And I pray, Father, that you will continue to come and bless the giver, Lord. They will, in turn, Lord, be generous in giving unto you. So bless the offering and truly, Lord, use it for the extension of the kingdom in and through covenant, Lord. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Okay, we're going to have an announcement. The welcome of visitors. For those of you, I saw a few visitors this morning. You're here for the first time, second time. We welcome you to join us at the welcome corner on the first floor. We want to get to know you better and for you to get to know us as well. All right, so do come and join us. Yeah, amen. Okay, the next announcement is for the Sri Lankan mission trip. There's a short video that is prepared for us. Shall we see the video?
The language of Jesus is love. Just one word can bring healing and life to each heart that is hungered for kindness and truth through the trials and the triumphs of life. The language of Jesus is love. It tells the greatest story ever told. Such grace and tenderness mere words cannot express. The language of Jesus is love. Of this world and its wisdom, but my words would just get in your way.
Can I invite Elder Richard to come and share with us?
That's awesome. Thank you for the video that's prepared by Brother Stephen. Yeah. Now this reverse mission, where we actually brought the gospel to the migrant workers gathered in here in Singapore. There are few thousands of them actually, and of which we have actually 20,000 Sri Lankans that are being based here. And this outreach, this reverse mission outreach, actually have produced very encouraging results. Sri Lanka ministry has sent back some more than 200 converts back to Sri Lanka, with 10 of them in full time. So this returning camp is organized annually, and a core team of about 6 to 8 members in this ministry has been doing this for more than 10 years. Now, of course, the objective is actually to come alongside with the converts who have gone back to Sri Lanka, and then to encourage and to journey with them in their faith, and to bond with them and their pastors in the Word. Just a testimony, you saw that on the screen down there, there was this young girl called Suranika. Yeah. Now, her grandmother was a migrant worker here in the domestic help in the early 2000. Yeah. And she went back to Sri Lanka after her contract is over, and then she brought her son and the daughter to the church and to work together with us, especially so in the returnees camp. And they are very faithful. Since then, every year that we went up to Sri Lanka, yeah, they will be there. And the granddaughter, Sranika, was a student then, and she helped us in the translation of our messages into Sinhala, right? And of course, they're very poor people, and then, Brother Stephen and myself put in some money to sort of buy a computer, for her, because she was in secondary school and she needs the computer and they can't afford. And then, then after that, she went on to university. Today, with the help of the computer, of course, the learning and so on, yeah, she's now a lawyer. And every year she will come down, to join us. And this year she just got married. So this sister Agnes has actually left a very wonderful testimony and a legacy, for her generation to follow after her, right? So for this trip, we are going back again on August 10th to the 20th. Now, we are now looking for toys, soft toys. Soft toys, about 50, 60 of them. Now, should be about this size of the toy.
Not this size.
Yeah. We need these toys for the orphans as well as for the children of our Sri Lanka members. Now, please put it in a plastic bag and leave it at the green store, but put it in the plastic bag. Not otherwise, it'll be sold off, by people coming in to just pick up the toys and so on. So these toys are meant, for the Sri Lankan treatment. Now, please make sure that the toys are decent, nice, comfortable, and so on, and not broken down and so on. Give it to us, and then we'll send this to Sri Lanka, and then help them to distribute that to the children down there. Right? Okay, that's all that I have to say. Today is our closing day for those people who are interested to join us. We are expecting probably about 10 people to join in this trip. Thank you.
Thank you, Brother Richard. I encourage all of you. You have considered to join the trip. I think it's a meaningful trip. You'll be able to see the returnees and their family. Can I have the next announcement? Oh yes, just remember next Sunday, so fast, a half a year has gone by. 2nd July, we're going to have our ministry community meeting after lunch. So lunch is provided for everyone. The whole idea is that we will fellowship and to really get to know one another better and bond together as a family. All right, so remember, next Sunday, lunch is provided. And then this coming Thursday, on the 29th, every fifth Thursday, they will have this mission prayer meeting. We are praying for the nation. So we'll be sending out the Zoom link to your live group, and then to encourage you to join us at 8 p.m. on Thursday to pray for the nations. The next, oh yes, coming 1st July will be the beginning of the season for the 40-day of prayer. They no longer print booklets, okay? They will be putting online videos, and this is a new season for them. They are actually engaging about 40 person, young and old, church statesmen, and even for young adults to write in this devotions for the 40 days. Can I have the next slides? And this will start the 1st July, and you will continue on, and it will be online for us. The next slide, it will be from 1st July to the August 9th. August 9th, they always have this day of His power. And it's already prepared in all the different websites. Can I have the next one? Yes. You can go on to the Facebook. You want to take this picture if you want to. Okay, you'll be on the Facebook, Instagram, YouTube. You can go on to Love Singapore Online. So every day, they will feature a short video devotion, and then they will lead us to pray, okay, for the nation. The nations as well for Singapore. All right, so this is important for us, and we really encourage all of us to be able to join in. So as one nation, we pray for Singapore to turn Godward, and to also pray that indeed for the next generation, winning the youth and also blessing the nations. These are the three focus that they have. All right, can I have the next slide? Okay, we have Carissa and the team who have prepared this video for us. Shall we thank the church camp committee? Done a great and wonderful job at the camp, and we want to thank the Lord for that. Okay, shall we all arise as we recite our discipleship DNA in covenant? Reading.
We want to grow in Christ likeness, devotion and delight in God, nurturing relationships, and intentional multiplying of disciple makers. Amen. Pass this time to Pastor Henry.
Let us receive the blessing. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of a good Father, and the empowering presence of the Holy Spirit rest on you, remain with you now and forevermore. Amen. Amen. Can we just turn around and just greet each other and wish each other.